All right. So my talk is about sustainable development. And you might think, sustainable development, ain't nobody got time for that. But first, I wanna learn a little bit about you. Who here is actually doing iOS? Like, okay, that maybe like 20%. Who does Android? Okay, another one. Okay, then, no matter if you do iOS or Android or anything else, who works on a code base who is older than 3 years? Older than 4 years? 5? 6? 7? Yeah, no, we only got 10% now, or something like that. Why is that? So I'm working on a code base where the first code was checked in December 2009. So it's about 7 years, give or take. And the project is still in a good shape. What does it actually mean, good shape? That means when we onboard new people, they might be a little bit overwhelmed because it's a lot to take in, but they don't run away screaming. And we have a lot of C++ in there. And really, they usually can get going pretty fast. And given that we are a remote company, this is important. And nobody so far brought up a full rewrite either, at least not yet. Now, I've given a variation of this talk a few weeks ago in Budapest, and the discussions afterwards were pretty interesting. Many projects are quite a mess, and it seems like the tipping point is 4 years, and after that, like, people just really want to think to start over. So this talk is a little bit about what can you do against it, and how can you fight this. And depending on where you are, some things might be trivial, some things might be great. If you find one thing that you can take away from this talk, I already achieved my goal. So a little bit about me. My name is Peter Steinberger, StyPete on Twitter. I come from Vienna. During the day, I work on PSPDFKit. This is not a pitching talk, so we do PDF stuff on mobile and web. I started a long time ago. And we ship 293 releases since I started. So that code base has quite a history. And in 2010, who already did iOS in 2010? From the people who, I think, five hands, six hands. So 2010 was a very different time. You still had to do manual memory management. And sometimes even using Objective-C was too slow, so you had to go down to C. And you had to implement vue.unload because iOS was still a little bit weird and really needed all the memory. Nowadays, an iOS extension already gets more memory than your whole app got a few years ago. Many of the choices and assumptions back then were compromises. Like much of the code that we wrote were not ideal, were written in a way that was fast. And those assumptions can change. For example, I used two open source frameworks before Apple even introduced UI collection view in iOS 6. So it took them 6 iOS iterations to offer a good grid view component. And it was absolutely worth the wait. Your collection view is a great API. And I was sitting at WWDC at the Apple conference in San Francisco when they announced that they now have UI collection view. And that was the moment where I decided, OK, I'm going to rewrite this myself. Because in Apple land, you usually support N-1. And I really wanted to use the new API right away, but I couldn't because there was still this requirement to support iOS 5. Now it seems like Stone Age. And it's not like in Google land where you get a support library and Google does everything for you. In Apple, they basically just want you to update, and good luck if you don't. And back then, I also didn't have the money for a good decompiler, so I basically just looked at the headers and really tried to figure out what's going on. And PSD Collection View was born. And I made one mistake here. I tried to be too clever. And I made it in a way where it automatically forwarded to UI Collection View when it's available. So it was like some really clever runtime hacking that just switched over the actual class. And I thought, oh, this is awesome. So no bugs when I'm on iOS 6, and iOS 5 just uses my own implementation, which is probably good enough. And that project turned out to be very, very popular, to a point where someone from Apple at some point contacted me. Actually, someone who was working on the Objective-C runtime. And he told me that all apps that use my library crash on iOS 7. And because I tried to be too clever, and I didn't think of a case where the EVA layout maybe grew. I didn't even know what an EVA layout was back then. And I fixed it in time, and most people didn't even notice that there was quite a mess. And what do we learn from that? We learned that boring is good. Don't always hop on the latest tech. Don't try to be all too clever. Even if you understand what you're doing, your team might not. And it always needs twice the brain power to actually debug your code, so you should leave some room. Boring code rarely causes surprises. At most, it's verbose, it's slow, but it's rarely the cause of major bugs. Clever code, though. So this talk is mostly about story time, so here's another story. In the early years, I designed an annotation model. Annotations are like drawing and like highlighting, like all the things that you can do on top of a page. And I thought it should be extensible. So what do? You just scan the runtime, and you ask it for, give me all subclasses that implement this certain, like this subclass, this certain class. And then add this to a map and like do all the things automatically. This is going to be great. And it worked. Up to a point where a customer was complaining that, like, we basically got an email saying, hey, your library is great, but why does it take 5 seconds to load? And it's like, 5 seconds? That's not true. It can't be true, right? So we investigated and eventually found out that this one customer has 50,000 classes because they used a lot of code generation. And my nice algorithm that scanned everything just was a little bit slow. So I tried to make it faster and didn't really work out. So eventually I just ditched it and changed it into one call that's called register class, where people could register their own annotation classes. And guess what? No problems ever since. This was like 5 years ago. We didn't really touch that code. It just works. Actually, the opposite was true. Before, when we still had the magic, we sometimes got support requests from people asking, so how do I register my custom class? Because they were expecting the boring one, the, OK, I have to register this somewhere. We're not thinking that we might do everything automatic. So boring is good. Boring doesn't surprise. Oh, yeah. Remember that PSD collection view bug? So back then, I really, really didn't want to give up on that idea of this automatically moving forward. So guess what broke on iOS 8? Somebody else fixed it for me. Which brings us to refactoring. So you should always be in refactor mode, all the time. If you constantly do this, it will never become painful. Your code base will stay fresh. And it will be easier to add features. It also doesn't really take much time. At PSPDFKit, we have the motto of always leave the room cleaner than you found it. So refactoring doesn't need to be perfect. You don't need to fix all the issues in your classes. Every bit helps. As you read, just rewrite things, add generics here, convert some older code to like better casting. Add a mapper filter if you see a manual for loop. Add asserts. The best asserts are those that say should never happen. So add a lot of those. With a large code base, it gets impossible to refactor everything at once. So we don't even try. Basically, every time we implement a feature or a fix, we always have lipstick, we call them lipstick commits, that just clean up little bits of the code. And that's discussible. It certainly makes the pull request more noisy. You always get like actual fixes and a bunch of random changes. But the other way is that you do it in a separate pull request. And if you're honest, your day only has so many hours, so you probably end up not doing them at all. So bigger changes. They should be planned like features, like create an issue. If you stumble over something that's not great, write it up, discuss it. Make a proposal how to make it better. Learn from the shortcomings of your old code. And then plan it in a sprint or a milestone or whatever you use to do project management. Bigger refactoring sometimes take time, but they're always worth pursuing. So a story time. Which also brings us to technical debt. Who knows what ARC is? Yeah? So ARC is the automatic memory management from Apple, which basically the compiler does everything for you. And when I started, that wasn't around yet. So eventually, we migrated to ARC, which seems like a good idea, because humans make errors. So I ran the converter, everything worked. There was just sometimes when you scroll fast enough, a crash in _ Objective-C fatal. And I had like no idea. So this one crash took me over a week to understand and fix. So the actual conversion, 20 minutes, one crash a week. And that really took a lot. And I almost gave up, because who do you ask when you see like a random crash without a stack trace very deep in the runtime? But the point here is, like, when you encounter problems like that, try hard to not give up. Because if I wouldn't have done that, I wouldn't have ARC for a long time. And my motivation of like attacking this problem would be very low after knowing that there is a huge problem. And that's often how technical debt starts. Another problem is hacks. And I'm sure everybody here wrote a hack. Everybody's been here. Especially in iOS, if something's acting weird, you just wrap it into a dispatch async, and you do it in the next run loop, and it works. And sometimes there's a crash where you just retain something a little longer and it's fixed. And you feel a little dirty and you move on. Until the thing comes back. And hacks often come back. And once you have a bunch of hacks interacting, you get a whole new level of bugs and you're in a fun place. So I found this code beauty a few weeks ago in our code base. And the code calls can become first responder, which is, it's just together. It doesn't do anything. It has no side effects. It just returns a Boolean. And we call it, and we don't actually do anything with the result. Actually, it's not even possible to get the result with that method. Why? Well, luckily, I made a nice comment, which says, hack, once you resign the first responder, even if it's not the view controller, the animation will fade and yada yada and might call back a window and the view controller crashes and a delay of 1 second might not be enough. So this is kind of like the worst crash, the worst thing that you can find. You have something that only crashes sometimes. You have no way to reproduce it. And the only thing that the comment says, it was found in iOS 7.1 beta or something. So I found this and I was like, ugh, I deleted it. And then I tried for an hour to reproduce it and to try to figure out what possibly could have triggered it. And I couldn't reproduce it, and so I assume it got fixed. And some insider knowledge, Apple actually only converted UIKit to Arc in iOS 9. So remember my story where I had a lot of problems adopting Arc early. It seems like they had a lot of problems too and decided it was not worth it and then did it 4 years later. And I don't want to know how much bugs that costed everyone, including me. But it's just a theory. I don't know if this was actually the case. This was the reason why this bug was fixed. So what do you do? How do you deal with problems like this? Which brings us to bug reports. So last year I published a very popular blog post about writing good bug reports. And I'm not here to like promote that you should all do raiders and like report everything. But I want to encourage you, whenever you write an ugly hack, you should try to build an example project for it. Imagine if for the crash I showed you earlier, if I would have had an example project, I could have just opened it, run it on iOS 9 and 10, see that it's no longer crashing, and then move on. And it would have taken me 5 minutes. And I would have gotten this warm, fuzzy feeling of, oh, I made the code better. I'm sure that what I did was correct. Instead, I got this, I'm not sure. Maybe I introduced a new crash. Maybe I made it better. Don't know. So how can you actually enforce that? You get that by enforcing code reviews. Just don't merge other people's hacks if they don't have an example project or really explain what the heck's going on. Code reviews are essential. Don't skip them. Don't rush over them. It's a great way to learn from each other. You see what other people are up to. You see how other people work. You can improve and learn from them as you can like improve them by showing them what they missed. It's also a great way to detect patterns of code that are just dupes. Often when you write a feature, you don't see that you are writing something that's already written somewhere else. Like especially if you work weeks on something, code reviews always help to like reduce that or point out that there's already a helper for something. And fighting duplicate code is important. And a quick reminder, code reviews are not here to discuss code formatting. Code formatting is important, and it's especially when you write code, you should always optimize for readability, because usually you write code once or a few times, but you read it many times. And I know Java and Android, it's kind of like in Android Studio, it's in their DNA. And eventually, we also adopted Clang format for C++. And it really helped make things easier. But iOS, we didn't have any automatic formatting. And it doesn't seem to be very, very common. We had especially a lot of problems because we use Objective C++. And the default Clang format just didn't know about a few things that we really liked. So I hired somebody a few months ago, and he was asking again, why are we not using code formatting for iOS? Because he came from the C++ side and just assumed that he was just like confused why we didn't. And we're like, here's this branch. We never got it to work. Clang doesn't support a few things that we want. So what do you do when Clang doesn't deliver? You fork it, and then you add a feature, and then you send the feature back upstream. So that like impressed me a ton. He did it on a weekend. And today is actually the day where we do our big iOS formatting. This was prepared for a few weeks. You try to get all your pull requests in, because if you do a big reformat and then you still have an open pull request with a lot of changes, it's a little bit annoying. And his patch literally touched 29 lines of code, and that includes a test. And it took like a few hours. And that was the blocker that prevented us from moving to Clang format for years. And everybody was like way too afraid of like, it's Clang, we cannot touch Clang. Nobody has an idea what's going on. He just did it. So get over your excuses. Another important topic is tests and continuous integration. So small secret, when I, it's actually not a secret. When I started, I worked alone on this framework. And it was before there were ICSI tests. There was something that called Send Test Kit, but I never really got it to work. Travis didn't exist yet, and nor did any of the other companies like CircleCI. Jenkins was there, but probably was still called Hudson, and really Jenkins is quite tricky to set up, and a full-time job, basically. We now actually have someone whose main job is keeping Jenkins and Jenkins workers alive. So meaning I didn't have CI, and my tests, I had tests, but they were manual or semi-manual. Like there was this giant test app, and I clicked it through, and I checked if things were correct. And of course, I didn't write down a script with the expectations what actually should happen. So you can imagine this was not a very good way to test a PDF parser when you change one thing and it can break 10 others. It kept me busy. And while it didn't cause a whole bunch of drama, certainly some of our customers were not amused. And now it's 2017, and we have unit tests, UI tests, code coverage, automatic performance benchmarks, and continuous delivery via Jenkins. And we have we have blog posts on a lot of those topics as well. Nightly builds are tested, and when the tests pass, they're automatically uploaded. And I couldn't imagine working the old way anymore. Sure, tests take a lot of time. And I spend a lot of time learning and fixing and deflaking them, especially UI tests. But it's very much worth it. And I encourage you to always like strive to like have as much tests and test coverage as possible. You should also automate whatever you can. You hear a talk later today about Fastlane, so cheers to Felix. That helped us a lot, from updating certificates to generating screenshots. We basically automated everything that you can automate. Another topic is dependencies. And that's something I see especially in younger developers a lot. There was a very popular blog post on MartianCraft's blog a few weeks ago about third-party libraries. And of course, they are an agency. They make software for money. So you have to take things with a grain of salt. But Ben made a very good point, which is whatever you gain now in convenience or speed will at some point need to be paid back. And you should simply just don't treat dependencies like Pokemon. You shouldn't collect them all. Ask yourself a few questions before you adopt something. Ask yourself, how popular is it? A lot of packet managers have statistics where you can like see how many people actually use it. So if it's a very popular project, the risk is lower. How old is it? When was the last commit? Age doesn't necessarily mean that it's good or it's bad. But if you have a project that's been around for a few years and is still maintained and updated, it's probably a good choice. Does it have tests? And what about code coverage? If there are like two tests, there might just well be none. How many contributors are there? Is this one person randomly hacking, or is it a team? Is it a company? Is it easy to like get new contributors in? Are they responding to issues and pull requests? How hard it is to rewrite? How complex is the actual problem? Is it just UI code with maybe some fancy animations? Or does it deal with encryption or parsing? And most of all, do you understand what it does? Is it easy to read? You should always be prepared to jump in and fix something if you take on a dependency. And if you have no idea what's going on, might not be great. And actually going through that list, pretty much all of my open source projects fail big time. Maintaining an open source project is a lot of work, and I have a lot of respect for people who do this. The probably most important thing is actually saying no to features, and I know this is hard depending on what role in the company you're in. And I was the one who could make the decision, and it was probably the thing that I was the worst years ago. It's too easy to say yes to a little feature, one more API addition, one special use case, and eventually you find yourself in a corner full of single-use features that really hurt you on refactoring. And it happened to us quite a few times where we built something for literally one company, and then, of course, years later, we took it away because we figured out nobody was using it, and, of course, that one company was screaming loudly, and we had to, sometimes cause a little bit of a mess. So, story time. We have a gallery in our framework, so you can make PDFs more interactive. You can add images and videos and websites and all that yada yada. And at some point, we had a bug where it was basically the customer was telling us, here, I set up this gallery and I load it on my iPad and it crashes. And we looked into it and we figured out, oh, yeah, your images, you're loading like 20, 30 megabyte images. It's too large. iOS tries to render them and just gets killed because it takes way too much memory. It's not a bug. It's your images are too large. And then we discussed this and we said, well, we could just write that back, or we write a partial renderer that just tiles the image. And because we had ambitions, right? So we did that. We built a tiled loader. And of course, we grossly underestimated the problem. So the whole thing turned out to become a multi-month project, completely redesigning how the gallery works and doing all these crazy things. And then that was just around the time where Apple moved to ARM64. And we used this one core graphics call where you could give it a JPEG and you could give it a rect, and it would only render that part of the JPEG, so you can get tiling without loading the whole image. Guess what broke in ARM64? So we built this great new feature. It took months, and it only worked on old hardware, because on the new hardware, that call still worked, but it loaded the whole image, which crashed again. So after like 3 months, we got back to the customer, which was obviously mad. And in the end, we just figured out that it was basically pointless and a bad investment of our time. And I could go on much longer and talk about documentation and sustainable working hours or the business model, but really, the only other important factor is your team. And here's the last secret. If you care about those good practices, you will attract good people, because good people want to do great work, and those practices help them achieve that and make a great product. So let's recap a little bit what we talked today. We talked about technology choices, why boring is good, why you should always refactor, and how you deal with technical debt, how you make your hacks manageable, why bug reports are important, and how much you can learn on code reviews. You know that tests are important, so I'm not saying anything there anymore. And you know that sometimes saying no to features is the best answer. That's it. Thank you.
Let's give a big hand for Peter Steinberger. Thank you for your talk.
Thank you.
We have a couple questions.
Sure.
Actually, I noticed there was one developer over here on the side. When you said Jenkins was difficult to implement or set up, there was someone shaking their head. Because our next speaker, Roman Pickel from Fluidtime, is going to talk about continuous delivery with Jenkins. So can you give some insights? Why do you think Jenkins is so difficult?
Actually, it's not. We always blame Jenkins, but mostly the iOS, the simulator, and the whole like Xcode, that's the problematic piece. Making sure that your tests run stable and that the simulator always delivers, that's actually the larger challenge. And of course, you always blame Jenkins when tests go wrong, but most often it's Apple's tools, which actually are not that great.
Wow. That's a lesson you've learned.
Yeah, that's a lesson everybody who does iOS learned, sadly.
Okay, well, we have one question here from Damir Svetan. What do you use for automated performance testing? Is there some product?
There's actually a Jenkins plugin, which you can like you can output the time your tests take and then run it through the plugin, and you see how your tests perform over time. And that gives you a good indication. You can do a lot more, but just by tracking time, how long existing tests takes will already give you a good indication how your code performs.
Super. Thank you. Are there any other questions in the audience? One here. Second. We have time for probably one more.
Hi. So you mentioned refactoring a few times during your talk. Yeah. So I was just wondering how, I don't know what workflow you used in your repository, but how, let's assume you use something like Git flow.
Yeah? You have a question.
How would you how would you integrate refactorings in your workflow, especially if you have big refactorings which go in parallel with other feature development? Yeah? I have often this problem that when I have a big refactoring and it's drifting away from the feature development because I have to submit something to my client, I have problems merging that back in. So how do you do that? Do you do it in a separate branch?
We actually try to never have... The question was about how... Yeah. We try to never have long-running pull requests. Like, sometimes it's inevitable, but a lot of times you can develop a second infrastructure. For example, you have the old cache, you write a new cache, and you just rename it to something so that they both can coexist. And then eventually you have like defines to switch over to the new one, and then you reboot the old one. That is more work than just refactoring it in place, but you can get it back to master much more often, and then still have like a fail-safe switch even. So it's a little bit like feature flags. You can often do that for refactoring. Not always, but in many cases it works.
We have one question here, last question.
Hey, first of all, thanks for a great talk. I would like to come back to your what you said about libraries and third-party dependencies. I find a lot of times that, especially now I've switched to Java a few months ago, and I found that a lot of Java libraries, for example, are very convoluted, very complicated, and I didn't really understand it. Maybe because I'm not a very experienced Java developer, but maybe because these libraries carry a lot of legacy stuff with them, legacy APIs. So I found that a lot of times it would be easier for me to re-implement a library with a very simple API, with only the functionality set that I needed. And a lot of times, from younger and from older developers, they tell, oh, you always like to re-implement your everything yourself. What would you answer these people when it comes to third-party libraries?
The problem always is it depends, and it's certainly a hot topic. There's people who love to like have everything in dependencies, and it's fine. Use dependencies, but be mindful of what you use. Rewriting everything from scratch also has its own risks. It takes time. You might create your own bugs. It's always a trade-off. You need to decide that case by case. Like there are certain libraries that certainly you should never try to even rewrite yourself, or like build systems like Gradle you should just use. But there's a lot of things that I see, especially in iOS, I'm not even talking about JavaScript, where people might use everything for one tiny bit in the dependency, and then it creates new problems. There's no silver bullet, I'm sorry.
Great. Peter Steinberger. Give a hand for Peter Steinberger. Thank you.